We're privileged to have Manjushree Thapa. She was born and raised in Nepal, US, and resides in Canada now. One of the most respected writers from Nepal, she's been writing extensively about her country, culture, and politics, both fiction and non-fiction, and even translation. She's been an inspirational figure for Sheeba Shah and a generation of writers. I request Manjushree Thapa to come to the stage. Kimmy, Katkar, Sheorey is a model turned Hindi film actor. She's had a very, very hectic career and has acted in over 50 movies. A lot of the other people might have seen on television a very famous film called Hum with Amitabh Bachchan. That was one of the most famous films of hers. She now loves and lives in Goa, and she's an avid baker. She's also an artist, a connoisseur of fine cooking and food. Kimmy, please. Sheeba Shah is from Nepal and is the author of novels Beyond the Illusions, Facing My Phantoms, and Now, The Other Queen. Sheeba now lives in Goa, loves movies, and runs a theatre group, Imaya Shows. In fact, she produces and also acts in the play Two Fathers, which debuted at GALF here last year, and since then has travelled around the country. She also acts in it. She is currently working on her new novel, which is based in Goa. Sheeba. Since it's a novel that most of you are yet to read and it's releasing and it's available here, I thought I'll just read out a couple of blurbs on the cover of the book, which sort of encapsulates quickly what the novel is about. In fact, I'll begin with what Manjushree Thapa says about the novel. She says, Sheeba Shah writes about intrigue, betrayal, and passion with great verve in The Other Queen, offering readers a rare chance to reimagine the past from a woman's perspective. The narrator, Rajendra Lakshmi, is the neglected wife of King Rajendra Bikram Shah of Nepal 100 years ago. She is also the sister of the better-loved wife, Queen Samrajalakshmi Devi. While focusing on the narrator's inner life, the author also shows how her fate is entwined with that of the nation. The story is as dramatic as it is enjoyable. That's what Manjushree Thapa says. And another author, Prajwal Parajuli, who's the author of Gurkha's Daughter, he says it is cinematic. Sheeba Shah weaves meticulously researched history with a taut storyline to give us the tale of an extraordinary anti-heroine in The Other Queen. The Other Queen provides an imaginative account of life as it was in the royal court of Nepal in the pre-Rana era. For the first time, this story candidly unveils the intimate life of Queen Rajendra Lakshmi and how her reckless actions snowballed towards 14 September 1846 AD, a ruinous night of delirious carnage, thus ending the era of the ruling dynasty and heralding the emergence of a rival faction. So that's to give you an overview of what the novel is about. Now with no delay, I'll request Wendell Rodricks to kindly inaugurate or release the book.
I want to start with asking Manjushree. You have written extensively and very effectively about contemporary Nepal, you know, in various aspects. And now you have read The Other Queen and appreciated it. What did you like about it, and why is historical fiction relevant to today's readers at all?
Thank you. I'm really pleased to be here. I love this novel, so I'm really thrilled that it worked out that I could be here for the inauguration. The novel is, you know, so I think any of you who follow Nepal's news very casually may have heard of the 2001 royal family massacre. When I was living in Nepal at that time, and I think Sheeba would have been too, and and it was an experience, the 2001 royal family massacre, when we all, I think, collectively realized that the past is not the past. That, you know, the kinds of massacres and murderous history that we had read about in our history books was very much in the present life of Nepal too. So I love, you know, this, the Kotparwa massacre, which is the event around which this novel is built, took place 100 years ago, or what was it,
1846,
yeah. So that was the time of this massacre, and we all had to read about it in our history books, and the queen was always blamed for the massacre. And you know, she was a very powerful queen, Rajadhilakshmi. She was in the middle of a lot of court intrigue. And so we grew up always thinking, okay, it's her fault that this massacre happened, and then the Shah dynasty was eclipsed by the Rana dynasty for 100 years. So it's wonderful to be able to read a novel that gets us into her perspective of events and really brings the past alive and explains to us, you know, the inner life of the court and the inner life of all of this intrigue and drama that has shaped Nepali history until 2008, when Nepal ended its monarchy after more than 250 years. So it's a wonderful view into contemporary Nepal, even though it is set along the
Kimmy, you mentioned that you actually have been out of touch with reading for a while, and then since Sheeba is a friend, you sort of reluctantly picked up this novel almost as an obligation to start reading it, and you thought that in the beginning, oh my god, this is a lot of history, this is just years and details and strange names, I don't know if I'm going to continue reading it. And then something happened. Please tell us about it.
Hi. When Sheeba gave me this book to read, I was apprehensive because I'm victim of digital technology right now. So I don't read as much as I used to. And when Sheeba gave me this book to read, I thought maybe it would give me an insight into her, since we had just become friends. And but then when I started reading it, it just became just too much for me to handle, because this was too much dates, there was just too much, too many names I couldn't comprehend, because probably, you know, it was Nepalese, and I just, and suddenly when the human aspect started with the queen and her life and being neglected and the competition with her sister and an impotent husband who I thought was, you know, he just didn't have a spine. And then I was totally hooked. It was just riveting, you know, just the betrayal, the, you know, just politics and how this woman's love for a man just made her become reckless and eventually led to the tragedy that eventually happened. So yeah, it was a great read once I passed the beginning of it.
I guess a lot of people might have a similar journey.
Well, I don't know. I'm not into history. I'm a more of a Mills and Boon reader, like. But I like light reading. So it was, but once I started it, and then there was just no going back. I mean, it was great to read about Nepalese, you know, royalty, what happened. But the human emotion behind the whole thing, as to why the queen did what she did, I think as a woman, I could empathize with her. And
good job.
Wendell, why do you think the a woman protagonist is so much more complex
and how so much more riveting in this day and age.
Well, quite simply, women are more interesting than men. As a fashion designer, I keep hearing, they tell me stories that they don't normally tell, even their own doctor and or their husbands. I hear all sorts of stories. I know exactly when a woman walks into the shop and she starts buying up the shop. I know that her husband is having an affair. She's taking out revenge on his plastic car. So if I see your partner coming in shopping mercilessly in my shop, I know something's wrong with you. Jokes aside, I think, women are fascinating for me as subjects because they are so multi-dimensional. I always feel that, especially Indian women, I don't know how they do this, they are like devis with many hands and many heads. I have seen ladies in Bombay who come from real middle class backgrounds where they will wake up in the morning at 5 o'clock and start cooking for their husband and children, whatever it is. Then they'll go on a train, but before they've got onto the train, they'll buy some vegetables and they'll be cleaning the vegetables in the car, in the train, in this crowded train, reach the office, do something during lunch, come back in the night and then they start cooking for the evening and stay up late and wash the clothes. And this is something really fascinating and I think only women can do. And I think in this book, what happens is this lady was responsible for the downfall of an entire dynasty. So more power to her. I think that for reasons that are completely different from what you would expect as to why this dynasty fell and another one came into its place. So these historical referrals, I mean, you read somebody like Manupillai's book Rebel Sultans, and when you come to the Chand Bibi stage, she's like the only woman over there in the entire book. And then you kind of perk up because here's a woman going to war and leading men and whatever it is. I think, and that is something really fascinating for me. It's always been fascinating for me. In my last book, Puske, I made sure that the protagonist became Alda with all these magical powers. She suffers the most in the book. But I think the beauty of women, and I don't mean to put the men down, but they will get put down eventually. The beauty of women is that they can pick themselves up and go. I remember when my own father died, I said, my poor mother, she's not going to manage this thing anymore because he did everything. He treated her like a queen. She did not go into the shopping. She barely woke up just in time for tea, which he had already put on the table. And I said, now that he's gone, I don't know how she's going to manage. But no, she managed really beautifully. And that is the strength of a woman, that she is going to manage your... You know, you see couples, if the woman dies, the man falls to pieces and needs another wife immediately. But if the man dies, I've seen widows of 63 learning how to ride a scooter and doing everything that he did. And I think that's the great thing.
Sheeba, I'd like to ask you how someone like you, who's now become a bit of an inspiration for the younger people in Nepal, in the sense that you were a high school pass, you never went to a philosophy or literature course, you never went to college, you were almost a self-taught person. You read, you said you read and learned writing, and you came up the hard way as a writer. I wanted to ask you, how did you get to writing in English? Tell us your story. Maybe
yes,
sir. Yeah.
Yeah. As you mentioned, Srinivas, I'm a high school dropout. I'm the only I'm a high school dropout. And how did I get into writing? I got into writing because of boredom. Boredom, as we were just discussing last night, you know, it's slowly dying in the millennials. They have so many gadgets. in their hands, that they don't, that creativity is slowly disappearing. But I got into writing because I lived in a very remote village with no electricity, there was no television, and at that time there were no mobiles, there was no texting, we did not even have proper drinking water. All there was nature around me. So what could I do? Out of boredom, I would dream. I would talk to nature around me. I would make, weave my own stories. And to take that further, I had to, you know, enhance my capacity of writing, my creativity, by reading. And so I became a very avid reader, collecting whatever I could. Nepali literature, Hindi literature, whatever in hand I could get, I would read it and devour it. And I think that honed my skills. And yes, that is how I got into
it. Unfortunately, we seem to have run out of time. I really want to thank Wendell Rodricks, Manjushree Thapa, and Kimmy Katkar for gracing the occasion and being so
outside. Please do buy them.